The Out of Bounds Show podcast is brought to you by BankPlus. BankPlus, it's more than a name, it's a promise.
WRPS Pickens Jackson.
You ready?
Let's go!
10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Now live in the BankPlus Studio, where college football meets the all lifestyle.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is
the Out of Bounds Show with Bo Bounds. Streaming around the world live at the Out of Bounds radio app. And on your radio at ESPN 105.9.
Where are you?
The Zone.
And good morning. Welcome in on a max effort Monday post Golden Egg rivalry weekend and the coaching carousel that gives us the silly season. Wendy says it's like Desperate Housewives of college football. I thought she kind of nailed that on Friday or Saturday whenever she threw that out. Want to say good morning, welcome in. It's been a while. Wow, we are the Out of Bounds Show, 105.9 The Zone, ESPN. Blake walked right in this morning and said he missed me. I mean, it's incredible. We have not done a show together in, I think, a week and a half.
What?
Yeah, I think it's been a week and a half, or maybe 2 weeks this Wednesday. So I've been out of the studio and on the road, and then we took a couple of days off. I'll let Blake Mania make sure that he got his turkey and dressing. And so I think it's been about 2 weeks. Tell our listeners what you were saying earlier about how much you miss me.
I'm good, Bo Bow.
All right, we're powered by the Golden Moon Casino Sportsbook and award-winning Dancing Rabbit Golf Club. We're streaming live on the Out of Bounds radio app. We're going to make a strong push on that the next, 4 weeks as we go into, you know, New Year's Eve and the end of the year. So we're excited about that. That thing's been hammered and gobbled up, and we want it on your phone. We want the Out of Bounds radio app on your phone. You can hit us up on the Farm Bureau Insurance call-in line. We'll go back to the number that we usually have, 601-707-3750, brought to you by Farm Bureau Insurance. Bundle your auto and home and save with your local Farm Bureau Insurance agent. Twitter handle. Depends on who you are, where you are. These Twitter streets can be violent. Twitter handle at Bo Bounds. And then your Ag Up equipment, Mississippi Ag, John Deere Tractor text line is, maybe you forgot over the last couple of days, 601-885-3776. 885-3776. We'll start with the game in Stinkville or Stark Vegas, Mississippi. And Ole Miss goes back to back for the first time since 14-15. Back to back wins in the battle for the Golden Egg, and they win 31-21. Over Mississippi State. And it was 10-6 at half. And then Ole Miss put it on Mississippi State in the third, but I guess you could say fourth quarter, with two touchdowns and pulled away. And Mississippi State scored a little bit late, but that game was in the books. I guess you could argue maybe by the beginning of the fourth quarter, it was 17-6. And then Ole Miss went ahead and shut the door on the Dogs. And I want to start with a couple of things. If you just want to take the last 4 years of the, I mean, we could go on and on, but usually when you have the best player, you win the game, especially at a position where, you know, that matters, that has a, that is a valuable position. Ole Miss, they had the best player on the offensive side of the football and the defensive side of the football. So Matt Corral is the best quarterback in America. He should win the Heisman. No, it shouldn't be Bryce Young. But I know Bryce Young had his Heisman moment, and because he plays at Alabama, he probably wanted on Saturday. And that was a fun, cool game, and I'll get to that in a minute. But when you lead a program, when you elevate a program, when you elevate everybody around you, when you're able to mask your team's deficiencies, when you're able to, you know, make mistakes and you're so good that you can overcome them, like Matt Corral, then you're a different level player. You're obviously a first-team All-American type talent. You should be QB1 in the NFL draft. But Ole Miss had the best player on both sides of the football, Blake, and they had Matt Corral, QB1, and Sam Williams. And, you know, if you go back to last year, Ole Miss had the best two players on the field. Who are they? Matt Corral and Elijah Moore. You want to go back 3 years, Mississippi State had the best two players on the field. Who are they? Willie Gay, Colin Hill. So you see where I'm going here. And obviously I picked Ole Miss to win. I guess maybe the way the game played out, not surprised me, but it was a little bit different. But there's so many variables involved. And so they take the golden egg, 10-2. Will they get in the Sugar Bowl?
It's a great chance.
It is. It is. We'll see what happens, I guess, with, I mean, Georgia and Bama?
Yeah, so I guess for Ole Miss, the worst case would be Bama losing to Georgia in a way that they can't get in the playoff, and I guess Alabama could get the sugar over you because they finished ahead of Ole Miss technically.
They finished ahead of Ole Miss technically. What will the voters do after a loss? Ole Miss is not going to play.
Exactly.
What will the voters do after a loss? If Bama lose, I know it's a lot of people are foregone conclusion. I know y'all saw the line at 6.5. It may have moved since then. I haven't checked it since yesterday at 1:30. Once the whole Florida and Oklahoma stuff broke, I moved away from ATS and all that kind of stuff. But the bottom line is Ole Miss finished 10-2. Lane Train's rolling. The Pirates 0-2. He's got to be careful. He's not on the hot seat by any stretch. They had a good year, not a great year like Ole Miss. And he had some great wins, but this game means an enormous amount to both sides. And you can't, Blake, you can't stack L's in this rivalry game. So, and it'll be more pressure on Leach because he's going to Oxford. I mean, even though Ole Miss is losing some good players, you never know what, if Lane Train's there, you never know what Lane Train can do in the transfer portal at QB. And we'll see. You know, I mean, they could flip it at, they won't necessarily have a Matt Corral, but they could have a very good QB, which is what you're trying to do at State, Ole Miss, Arkansas, South Carolina, Michigan State type programs, so that they can overcome some of the spaces and places where you're not as talented.
One, no matter what they lose, like you said, being on the road and being that you lost two in a row, that there will no doubt be pressure, and it will be an intense game to win next year. But that's a year away. I thought this year's game was perfectly encapsulated what Mississippi State under Mike Leach has been this season, which is a team that gives you opportunities to win but certainly hampers their own ability to win at times as well.
Yeah.
I mean, the offense did exactly what we talked about, which is start slow in the part that mattered the most, which is scoring in the red zone. You actually got great opportunities. I mean, Kiffin kind of shot himself in the foot on the opening drive.
Sure.
Going for it on fourth down, giving you a short field. But you couldn't score a touchdown. You end up missing multiple touchdown opportunities. You missed two field goals. I mean, that's kind of been...
When you're playing Matt Corral,
you can't... Yeah. I mean, your defense played great.
Right.
Your defense did... At the end of
finally,
the third quarter...
Finally, the dam broke.
Exactly.
But they played well for a while.
It was seven... You had given up 17 points through three quarters, basically.
You could tell Corral was frustrated.
Yeah.
And then the dam eventually broke in the fourth quarter.
If you score touchdowns in the first half and you give up that 10 points at half or 17 in the first three quarters, you're ahead of schedule if you're Mississippi State, you know? And so that's been what this team has struggled with all year, though. I mean, La Tech, it started with game one in Louisiana Tech. You get down... You did it to Memphis. You couldn't come back. You did it to LSU. You couldn't come back.
Those were the three that I think really jumped out. And Ole Miss. La Tech, Memphis, LSU, and Ole Miss. They showed their youth.
The Out of Bounds Show podcast is brought to you by Boar's Head. Premium meats, cheeses, and hummus. Boar's Head. Compromise elsewhere.
What's on the big board?
Blake asked an interesting question during the break. We'll hit on that in just a second on the big board. Ole Miss, back-to-back Golden Eggs, Lane Train 2, Pirate 0. I don't think it's any cause to panic. I mean, Ole Miss was better last year, obviously. And they're better this year. When you have a QB1 NFL dude, golly, that young man is unbelievable. One of the most talented quarterbacks to ever play in the state of Mississippi. That includes Brett Favre, McNair, Eli, Dak, Archie, Reggie, you know. I mean, we've had some good ones. But he is up there. He is he's probably not taking a back seat to anybody as far as college-level play. We'll see what he does in the pros. If you've listened to the show, you know that I think he'll go top 5, top 10. As Blake said, we just got to see what the draft order looks like for Matt Corral, right? So many of these teams have drafted QBs. They're still not winning. You know, I don't know how that looks. And then for teams that may want to make a play for Matt Corral, what is their draft capital? You know, what is realistic for them to do to get up there? I know a lot of you would like to see him at the New Orleans Saints. I just have no idea, you know, exactly how that will look. Well, hopefully it'll look better than the Saints did against the Bills on Thursday night, but I don't know how it'll look several months from now. But Matt Corral loses his first two Golden Eggs and wins with an exclamation point his junior and senior year. What Will Rogers is going through. Playing this game as a freshman and sophomore is very, very difficult. And we've got plenty of quarterbacks who know that. And then playing it as a junior and senior is a whole different ballgame. And Matt Corral was the best player on the field, and then Sam Williams was the best defensive player on the field. And, hey, Ole Miss, you know, Blake, when they needed it, they got it. And Corral has the ability. It doesn't matter what the down. What was it? Second and 22.
Yeah, that you're talking pass about he threw to Drummond across the middle. Yeah,
I mean that was a beautiful. There. I don't know if there's another QB in college football that can make that throw, but that was a beautiful, you know, pitch and catch. And Drummond worked number 19 all night. Kiffin looked at the tape for 10 minutes the Sunday before. They realized what they were going to do. And they exploited that weakness that we actually mentioned on Wednesday. Hey, we're live in the Bank. I haven't been able to say that in a while. We're live in the Bank Plus studio. The Out of Bounds Show, 105.9 The Zone, ESPN, WRKS, is brought to you by Bank Plus. It's more than a name. It's a promise. The Big Board this morning is brought to you by MississippiSportsMedicine.com. MississippiSportsMedicine.com. I ran into Dr. Graham Calvert recently. Shout out. We'll have to get him in and on the show and hang out a little bit. But the show is powered by MississippiSportsMedicine.com. Want to welcome you in. Blake, did you get your... I mean, this was something that people were concerned about. Did you get your Thanksgiving fix? Not on Thanksgiving, but eventually over the weekend.
Yes, I did.
Okay.
I got a better fix than the Oklahoma fans who had to watch Lincoln Riley walk out the door.
Oh, wow. We're going to get
Sunday
that.
Morning.
Okay. Yeah. What did you... What?
They're hanging traitor banners on the stadium at Oklahoma.
Really?
Yeah.
Are you serious?
Yeah, true story. There's pictures on the interwebs.
On the interwebs?
That's right, yeah. Hanging banners on their big statue out in front of the stadium, and then on the stadium gates it says traitor in big red letters.
All right, let me lay that out for our listeners real quick. Again, the MVP of the Golden Egg, I guess, Matt Corral / Sam Williams. Again, Drummond played great. There were some other, Snoop had a couple of really, really nice plays. He is one, wasn't in the top 30. Was not in the top 30 of recruits in the state of Mississippi. And, I need to look at that group again, see where I would put Snoop. He'd probably be in the top 3-4 as far as talent, production. And he doesn't even get the ball. I mean, you know, they split it up between he and Ely and a little bit of Parrish. It's not like, you know, 25 years ago when Deuce or Michael Davis or Kevin Bowie or J.J. Johnson or any of these guys would tote the rock, you know, 22, 23 times a game. It's just a different deal, which actually I think works out for the players as far as wear and tear and trying to prolong their career, and they're hoping to gobble up 3, 4, 5 years, you know, minimum in the NFL. But Lincoln Riley left Oklahoma, is what Blake is referencing, to go to Southern Cal, which is a much better job. And I like my man Colin Cowherd, and I haven't listened to Colin in a week and a half. We've been on the road and been crazy and so on. And but I listened to Cowherd this morning driving in, and he said Oklahoma's a better job than LSU, and I almost drove off the road into a field to just hang out with some deer the rest of the day. But Oklahoma, so if Scott Woodward thought he had Lincoln Riley, LSU's athletic director, for my listeners, Lincoln pulled one. How about him saying, I will not be the next coach at LSU on Saturday night after losing to Oklahoma State? And by the way, that was Gundy's third win in 17 years in the rivalry. He was 2-14 going into the game. He's now 3-14. So maybe Mike Leach can lose Golden Eggs but stay around in Starkville for a while. I don't know. But Lincoln Riley to Southern Cal, and then Blake, your favorite coach, Billy Napier, from Louisiana Lafayette, or finally, now U of L, but finally, I like ULL. Billy Napier is the new head football coach for your Florida Gators and Scott Strickland and the University of Florida.
So now LSU's left holding the empty bag.
LSU's open. Oklahoma's open for now. Also, when you look at what, you know, did LSU pass on Napier thinking that they had something else? Scott Strickland met with Billy Napier last Tuesday, according to Ross Dellinger, SI.com. He flew to his home and had a meeting. Now, I don't know how they pulled that off. He went in some kind of SUV, pulled all the way in the garage. I mean, obviously, Napier's got, a beautiful spread in Lafayette, Louisiana, making over $2 million a year. Pretty sure you can live wherever you want. But evidently, Scott Strickland flew in without the Gators tracking him and met with Billy Napier and pushed to get the deal done. That's kind of the Mitch Barnhart way, isn't it, at Kentucky? That three of the 80s that we're more than familiar with go with. And I think it's the right way. But, I mean, they don't just expedite the process. They get after it to get somebody in place. That would be Greg Byrne, Scott Strickland, John Cohen. And it's just their MO to go, get it done as soon as you can. Have somebody leading the program, preferably within a day, 2 days, 3 days, once you really open that thing up. So, who goes to LSU? I want to ask our listeners. Ag Up Equipment text line. Ag Up Equipment, Mississippi Ag, John Deere Tractor text line. That's a lot. We're going to scale that down at some point. The text line is 601-885-3776. Also, I got to say to Steve, who texted us, congratulations to the Michigan Wolverines.
I watched every bit of that game. That was a phenomenal game on Saturday. Congratulations to Jim Harbaugh, to staying with the coach when you should, to allowing him to restructure his staff, and they absolutely dominated the Ohio State Buckeyes. We're live in the Bank Plus studio. The Egg Bowl stays in Oxford, and the coaching carousel continues.
The Out of Bounds Show podcast is powered by Breezy Oaks Ranch. For Mississippi-raised premium Wagyu beef and heritage pork shipped straight to your door, visit BreezyOaksRanch.com.
Come on, everyone ready?
This is the SEC Insider Hit. Presented by your local Farm Bureau Insurance agent. Go local. Go with a home team.
Whoa. All right. Good morning. Welcome in. The Out of Bounds Show, 105.9 The Zone ESPN, WRKS. We're streaming live on the Out of Bounds radio app. Show is brought to you by Farm Bureau Insurance. Bundle your auto and home and save with your local Farm Bureau Insurance agent. Woo! In all 82 counties in the great state of Mississippi, there's a Farm Bureau Insurance agent to help you and your family. Bundle your auto and home and save with your local Farm Bureau Insurance agent. So if you'd like to weigh in, we don't necessarily take calls in this segment, but if you'd like to weigh in because of the Golden Egg staying in Oxford, Ole Miss 31, MSU 21, Matt Corral, best player on the field, Sam Williams, best defensive player on the field. We walked you kind of through that earlier. Usually you have the best, especially if it's, I mean, if you have the best linebacker on the field or safety, this is not always the case. But when it's quarterback and edge rusher, whoo. I mean, I can walk you through the last four Egg Bowls real quick. Matt Corral, Sam Williams, Thursday night, best players on the field. Last year, Matt Corral, Elijah Moore, best players on the field. Year before, Willie Gay, Colin Hill, best players on the field. Year before that, Jeffrey Simmons and, well, Blake, kind of any way you want to go there. Nick Fitzgerald, there, best players on the field. So, maybe we overthink it at times. The result definitely did not surprise me. And Mississippi State, Blake mentioned it earlier, they made some mistakes to try to stay in the game, right? I mean, you can't drop touchdown passes and miss field goals against Matt Corral. He will make you pay. We'll talk about some of the explosive plays. The explosive plays this morning brought to you by Farm Bureau Insurance. Bundle your auto and home and save with your local Farm Bureau Insurance agent. Blake and I mentioned the explosive play, Corral to Drummond. Was it second and 22, Blake?
Something like that. It was long.
Drummond obviously had the 34-yard catch. Sanders had the 26-yard catch and so on. So, and hey, you know, when you look at rushing, Corral got just enough. That is one tough dude. He's like made of elastic and silly putty. He can bend, but he's not going to break. 12 rushes, 45 yards. Ole Miss rushed the ball 44 times. For 154, Arnett and the D did, you know, a pretty dang good job. It's just eventually when you give them opportunity after opportunity, the dam's going to break. So when you had the missed opportunity going into halftime for MSU, when you dropped three touchdown passes in a row, and then you came out, that was probably it, but then you come out in the second half and you go and you punt, that's kind of, you're playing right into Corral's hands, and he's just that good and that special. And so he ends his career in the regular season with another Golden Egg. I think he should win the Heisman. I don't think he will. To me, it's about elevating your team. How many other quarterbacks would you drop in Oxford and they go 10-2? How many other quarterbacks do you think around the country
could drive Ole Miss to 10-2 this year. Some would say Pickett at Pitt. I doubt it. Some would say Bryce Young at Alabama. No. And, you know, from there, you know, it's kind of whatever.
The latest updated odds, it's pretty much a lock. Bryce Young's walking away with
because of his quote-unquote Heisman moment against Auburn.
Was a 98-yard drive.
As a 20.5-point favorite.
98-yard drive with, what, a minute left or something like that? That moment in and of itself was impressive.
I'll give the young man credit. He got lit up like Corral, too. I mean, he got blown up.
Have you ever seen Alabama's offensive line perform for 60 minutes that poorly?
The right side of that line is awful. I knew it had been challenged. I didn't know it was that bad.
It got demolished.
To say that it's not good for Alabama standards, or maybe go ahead and throw in a bunch of other teams.
Yeah.
I mean, Ole Miss's offensive line is better than Alabama's offensive line. Granted, Ole Miss has had a really, really, really good O-line unit the last 2 years, but to the right side of that Bama line is, woo. I mean, Georgia is just licking their lips, their chops,
yes,
for this weekend in Atlanta for the SEC championship game. But back to Ole Miss before I get into some of the other rivalry games and the coaching carousel and the silly season. Not only, Blake, can you not score touchdowns in the red zone against a Corral-type player?
Yeah.
But you can't miss field goals, too.
Well, can I argue that Leach's, if you want to be upset about anything, if you're a State fan, you have to be upset about Leach deciding to kick 4 field goals. I think at that point, like, he kicked the 2 heading on the calmer side. When they were going into the student section, the way that wind was whipping through there, being there, and you were there too. You saw the flags on the goalpost. I don't know if you could tell that on TV. That wind was circling.
I was in that end zone.
Exactly.
In the scoreboard level.
We were at like the 15-yard line behind the state
bench. I was right
by
your guy, Jake Gautreaux.
There you go. You can't kick both those field. Like, I get that your receivers drop something and will miss Mekhi Polk early in the game, but I just don't know that you can settle for field goals like they did. Leach was willing to do with a walk-on kicker. So the game was lost by the offense in this one, not by the defense. I agree. Arnett and the Bulldogs did
considering
everything
Mississippi State doesn't have a special player on defense.
Yeah. And you
they
saw that.
They played really well for several possessions against Ole Miss, considering Ole Miss can hurt you in so many different areas. Now, look, the swing passes, I'll give Kiffin credit. The swing passes, I mean, Kiffin obviously either saw something going into the game or adjusted right there, but the swing passes to the boundary absolutely crushed MSU, Blake, right?
Yeah, I mean, it's a wear down. It's a little bit of like what Leach's offense is designed to do because Kiffin's offense runs the ball so effectively that when they start hitting those swing passes and those linebackers inch another 6 inches, a foot and a half out to the side, now all of a sudden Snoop is busting it up the middle for 10 yards. And so it's a wear down factor. And you saw the defense hold up for a little while, but they eventually wore down because your offense couldn't score.
So now where will Ole Miss go to the Sugar Bowl? And, you know, how will that look as far as the bowl games, the matchups, what happens this weekend around the country with the conference championship games?
Well, there's so much up in the air because Oklahoma losing again to Oklahoma State makes
and Ohio State losing again?
Yeah, that makes it almost impossible for Oklahoma State or Oklahoma to get in. I mean, I guess in theory, an Oklahoma State Big 12 champion could go to the playoff. Michigan, if they win their Big Ten championship game, will go to the playoff as a one-loss team.
How about Jim Harbaugh finally getting a win over the Ohio State Buckeyes? And that Bama-Auburn game was unbelievable. But you knew when Bigsby went out of bounds, didn't you? Didn't you kind of have the feeling when Auburn's running back decides to run out of bounds? And I know he was kind of – he locked up with the defender who worked him out too, but to not get down and stay in bounds and kill the clock gave Bryce Young just enough time to lead Alabama down and score. And Bama stays, well, I guess, Blake, alive for one more week.
Yeah.
Man, is Georgia living right?
Yeah,
they played Charleston Southern 2 weeks ago and Georgia Tech this weekend, while Bama has a physical game against Arkansas and then a physical game against Auburn. I mean, not only are they in the Week East, but their schedule down the stretch compared to the West, and Sankey somewhat addressed this.
It's changing.
A couple of years ago, if you're in the West, you have to march down and still play, you know, extremely difficult games. Man, if you're in the East, especially Georgia,
yeah,
to pull Charleston Southern and Georgia Tech to wrap up the year, and I'm not feeling sorry for Bama. I'm just laying it out that Bama played a physical game against Arkansas and a physical game against Auburn. And boom, now you've got the SEC championship game where Georgia's basically had 2 weeks off. And Bama's been fighting for their lives. I will say this. As bad as that Bama O-line is, Bryce Young, man, he's getting better. And they lost their number one receiver to targeting and still were able to pull it off. Again, props to Jim Harbaugh in Michigan. They had lost 17 of 19. Yes. Sorry. 17 of 19.
And Harbaugh was 0-for.
And Harbaugh was 0-for. And I think Michigan Steve will could weigh in on this. And I also text Steve Dace over the weekend, too. He didn't even watch it.
That's crazy.
Think about this rivalry. We've had some back and forth with Ole Miss and Mississippi State. Okay? Michigan had lost 17 of 19. And Oklahoma State had lost 14 of 16.
That's incredible.
Going into those games, to my listeners.
It just goes to show that this was the rivalry weekend of Little Brother. Michigan beat Ohio State. Oklahoma State beat Oklahoma. Ole Miss beat Mississippi State.
Shots fired.
It was just crazy. It was a lot of upsets.
The SEC Insider Hit this morning is brought to you by Farm Bureau Insurance. Bundle your auto and home and save with your local Farm Bureau Insurance agent. Your reaction to Blake's throwing some shade there. You can just, I guess, post a picture of the Golden Egg Trophy. The Ag Up Equipment, Mississippi Ag, John Deere Tractor text line, 601-885-3776.
Speaking of shade, how about Jim Harbaugh throwing some shade at Ryan Day?
Read exactly what I've got it bookmarked.
How about I give it to you in audio?
Do you have it?
How about I give it to you in audio
Okay,
form?
Hold on. Let me set this up for our listeners. Jim Harbaugh had not won one game against Ohio State since being in Ann Arbor. Okay? And the games in Ann Arbor, I don't know if you watched the game, but it was too good. It was unbelievable. And Harbaugh finally gets a W. And let me tell you what, Michigan dominated. That Michigan offensive line tore Ohio State up. Hey, and McNamara made some plays too. But this is Jim Harbaugh getting salty and throwing a couple more punches at Ohio State after the game.
What did? I mean, there's, yeah. I mean, I know that probably things you're thinking of the same as I'm thinking of, but, man, let's move on with humble hearts, take the high road. But, yeah, there's definitely stuff that, you know, people said that spurred us on even more. Sure. Sometimes people that are standing on third base think they hit a triple, but they didn't.
Oh. Oh. Oh.
Oh, man.
Now, we all know those people who think they've hit a, you know, were born on third but think they've hit a triple. What? All right, so let's break that down, what he's referencing, because we can go with two coaches, even though he wasn't talking about one of them. So for our listeners, he's talking about Ryan Day, who's the head football coach at Ohio State. And Ryan Day walked into an unbelievable situation. So I can't tell you, like, how great Ryan Day is. Ohio State's a machine. Urban Meyer left a healthy roster full of 4- and 5-star players. Give Ryan Day credit. He continued to win, right? But that was Harbaugh talking about, you know, being born on third, but thinks he hit a triple. Lincoln Riley, you could say the same thing, y'all. I mean, Bob Stoops left a healthy program, and Lincoln Riley took it and continued to win. But, like, how good are they? I don't know.
Well, they never got over the hump.
They don't face the same adversity as most coaches who, when they're hired, they're walked in to clean up a big, giant mess of sewage. And that's not what happened at Ohio State and Oklahoma. So Jim Harbaugh took some shots. Did you see Nick Saban and Terry Saban celebrate after the game?
You don't think he recognizes how much these are starting to mean to him?
Yeah.
It's changed.
The clock's ticking.
He's changed, yeah.
Yeah, and you know, yeah. He's north of 70 now. I don't know if she is or not, but you make a good point, Blake. There's a little bit more of, I don't know how many more of these I have before I go to the lake house in Georgia. And that was one heck of a win at Auburn. And man, you got to give Auburn. That is one tough, physical program.
Dude,
that never gives in. And with TJ Finley, they were able to lead, well, the whole game. Bama didn't lead until
overtime.
They won.
Yeah, but what a disaster of a season for Brian Harsin that started with
some
promise.
Some people are talking about him getting let go.
Yeah, they started with some promise. They were 6-2. They were 6-2 heading into that A&M game, and they lost at A&M, a game where they were never really in it. I mean, they kind of got physically dominated from the beginning. They lost a game where they had a 25-point lead at home to Mississippi State in the first half. Then they went on the road and lost to a South Carolina team that's been starting a walk-on equipment manager at quarterback. They lost to that team, and then they finished it up by blowing a lead to Alabama, which I get. It's Alabama, right. And it's hard to seal a win against Alabama, but it doesn't matter because all your fans see is that you were up 10-0 and you lost.
Right.
So you blew two home leads and you lost two games on the road, one to a team that's so inferior to you that, you know, you can't even yell down to them. They're that far behind you.
Yeah.
That's bad. That's a bad 4-game stretch for Brian Harsin.
No question. I couldn't believe it when someone said that they may be looking. Well, first of all, that Allen Green, the Auburn AD, his job may be in jeopardy, which I thought, okay, that's weird. And then another guy, Auburn insider, went as far to say, that maybe they both find a way to part ways. And I'm like, now I know Harsin, it looks like he's been making a play for the Washington job, but
he's more suited for that, right? Boise State, Washington.
Yeah, I don't think that's going to work out for him. And then there's the rumors about whether or not he's vaxxed. So that, you know, I don't know how that looks or what they do over the next few days. We do know that LSU is open and that Oklahoma is open.
Give me your top three candidates for both jobs. They're the two premier blue blood. So Billy Napier to Florida.
Right.
He finally left. We've been talking about Billy
Napier.
That's
a good hire for Scott Strickland.
And we've been talking about Napier for 4 seasons.
Yeah.
So, I mean, he finally went somewhere.
Good point.
Finally.
And he won big. And don't forget this. He moved ULL's recruiting
a ton.
Up.
A ton.
Big time. And let me just, I don't want to get too bogged down in this because I know it's morning drive and you're trying to get your kids to work or get yourself to work. But there is something called range-bound recruiting. 99% of teams never move up or back more than 4 spots. Okay? If you run the numbers in modern-day recruiting since 2000, if you're the number 35 recruiter,
you go 30 to 40.
Yeah, you may go to 38, you may go to 32, whatever, somewhere in there. But that's who you are. And Billy Napier broke through range-bound recruiting at ULL, La Lafayette. And I'm talking about really broke through.
Means he built a program for real. Yeah. So I think it's a good hire.
So he's going to Florida. Now, can he close the gap on Georgia?
And what does that mean? How close do you have to be competitive?
That's a good point. And also, Florida played Bama to one possession twice in the last year.
Yeah.
So I think a lot of people have gone a little overboard on how far away Florida is because of some of their terrible games against South Carolina and Samford and Kentucky. Anyway, so you wanted the candidate.
So Napier's Florida.
Mark Stoops is not going to move the needle for LSU fans. Ooh. So if he's the guy, now there's talk that Mark Stoops, head football coach at Kentucky, may be a front runner for Oklahoma. Well, who's his older brother? Bob Stoops, who's now the interim coach at Oklahoma. Y'all all know that.
Yeah, their second best coach in program history, right?
Right. Well, behind Switzer. You'd go Bud Wilkinson.
Okay.
Barry Switzer, Bud Wilkinson. Yes, but he's right there, okay? Yeah. And different eras, you know how it is. Yeah. Impossible to really compare. But Bob Stoops was at Oklahoma forever. He retired. He is now the interim coach. I don't know how long, whether that's a few days or whatever. And his brother is Mark Stoops at the University of Kentucky. Now, Mississippi State fans, what would you like to see happen? Because Ole Miss pulls Vanderbilt, who is by far and away the worst team in the Southeastern Conference by like miles and miles and miles. Well, Kentucky right now is rated 14th in recruiting. That's not good for you. And he has broken through range-bound recruiting too. And he has how Kentucky is out recruiting MSU, considering they're 10 hours north and there's no prospects around them, should tell you all you need to know about football recruiting in Starkville. But let me stay on this. Mark Stoops is around 13, 14, 15 in the country in recruiting. You would probably like for Mark Stoops to take another job because even though he's not great, he's really good at recruiting and really good on defense. Now, they've never been able to figure out the offense, which may be a weird hire for Oklahoma because Oklahoma's been this high-flying act since they hired Mike Leach in 1998 as the OC.
Do they hire Mike Leach in 2021?
Do they hire Mike Leach? Do they hire Lane Kiffin? I don't know. You mentioned LSU. Is it Lane Train? Is it Mark Stoops? Is it still Aranda?
Yeah.
I don't think any of those names are going to do it for LSU except Lane. They don't even know who Mark Stoops is.
No.
Okay? If you walked down the street in Baton Rouge, New Orleans, Lafayette, and all the other little towns in Louisiana, they would not be able to tell you who the head football coach is at Kentucky. They don't care. It doesn't interest them, and so on. So I don't think that Mark Stoops does it for them. And Blake, I don't think Dave Aranda, who is their national championship defensive coordinator, does it for them.
But he might be the best option left at this point.
He may be.
Give the offense to a OC and be the CEO style defensive head coach.
Maybe that's something that could work. Look, Les Miles and Ed Ogeron won a national title at LSU. So we know that you don't have to be a great coach to win there. That thing is a monster and it is a machine. The Out of Bounds Show is brought to you by Farm Bureau Insurance. Bundle your auto and home and save with your local Farm Bureau Insurance agent. Farm Bureau Insurance call-in line, 601-707-3750. Tom Luganville, National College Football Analyst with ESPN at 8:30 on Out of Bounds.